Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive. Thanks so much for joining us on yet another live stream. We did, of course, have our biggest live stream out of the whole series last week. We ran clean out of time. So this week is a rather unexpected part two to our Blues Concept Explained little series of streams it's become now. I would love to hear from you guys in the chat, by the way. If you have any questions, I will, of course, be answering all of your questions in the Q&A segment a little bit later on. But for the time being, I'd like you to let me know if you can hear me okay. Just want to make sure I'm coming through loud and clear for you guys. So drop a comment in the chat. Let us know wherever you're watching, whichever platform you're on, if you're hearing me loud and clear, if you're getting my voice okay, you're getting the guitar okay, you're getting the backing track okay. Want to make sure everything's as good as we can get it for you guys. So thank you so much for tuning in. It is really great to see you all. We have some friends in the stream already. I can see we'll be doing some shout outs a little bit later on, but before we go any further, let me tell you a little bit about what today's stream is going to be all about. We're going to be picking up from last week, so I will cover some of the concepts that we talked about last week, such as the phrasing ideas, taking inspiration from lyrical ideas, also how you combine major and minor pentatonics, how you might look at the blues scale in a slightly different way. We're going to pick up from there, and we're also going to talk a little bit about things like playing over changes, all that kind of business. We'll touch on that in just a moment. Before we do that, let me tell you a little bit about GI Plus, which is of course the lesson platform from Guitar Interactive, where you can check out every lesson that Guitar Interactive has ever put out, and a whole slew of additional great brand new content. It's really worth your time, guys. There is so much great stuff. You can check it out at the links that are going to be in the comments in this stream, wherever you're watching it, whether it's on YouTube, whether you're watching it on Facebook. It's all in there. You can check out the links in the description. You can also get all of the backing tracks that we're using in this week's stream, and of course all of our other streams on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. Before we talk a little bit more about that though, let me show you this. This is GI Plus. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today. So there you go, guys. That's GI Plus. There are links in the description. You can check all of that out at your leisure. Of course, you can check out all of my lessons and much, much more at GI Plus. There is a link right there for you guys. For our friends on Facebook, the same link is available to you. We also have some great comments from the chat. I'm going to just sort of really quickly delve into these before we get into the meat of today's lesson. Our friend, Michael Almedia. I have a student who was called Almedia, but I've heard it pronounced Almedia as well. Michael, if I'm mispronouncing your name, I do apologize. Michael says, sounds amazing. You could have made that look a little more difficult. Michael, I will gurn harder next time. For those of you who aren't familiar, gurning is the British sport of pulling funny faces. If you wanted to take a screen cap of this stream, now is the time, by the way. Looks a bit like this. And every guitar player has their own one. Walter Trout has some of the best. In fact, do you know what it is? Let us know your favorite guitar face in the comments. Which guitar player do you think has the best guitar face? I know my thoughts. I will save them for later. I'd also love to know where you guys are watching from too. So drop us a like, drop us a comment. Let us know where you're watching from. We'd love to hear from you. I also, you know what it is? I would absolutely love to do this. Our friend, Nam Pradhan, he says, please call my name once. Consider it done, my man. I tried my best. I'm terrible at pronouncing names, so if I butchered the pronunciation, you'll have to excuse me, but we are really glad to have you here. All the way from India, man, thank you so much for tuning in. We are going worldwide. Paulie D's music is back again. Gary Moore is a tough guitar face to beat. That is absolutely true. Okay, we got Jim Bukowski from Medina, Ohio. I'd love to know where you guys are watching from. We will absolutely check in with you guys in just a moment, but let's get stuck in with the meat of today's session. So just as a brief recap, let's talk about some of the concepts we touched on last week. I'm gonna throw the same backing track on from last week. Last week, we talked about basically kind of using major and minor pentatonic scales to kind of create almost like a conversational style. And we talked about the idea of changing them on a per phrase basis and also on a per chord basis. You might think about them essentially as the major pentatonic being almost like a sweet or a sorrowful tone in your voice. You might also think about the minor pentatonic as being a little more acid and a little bit more sarcastic. I want you to imagine for a moment that that's what I'm doing here. I'm going to go to the close-up cam. I'll just show you this very, very quickly. So just for the sake of argument, we're going to play in the key of A. I will just quickly breeze over this. Key of A is going to be major pentatonic down here in the second position, minor pentatonic down here in the fifth position. Other positions are available. I'm just going to show you this so you can see the concept in full swing. Real quick, let's throw a backing track on. You'll notice when I'm playing major pentatonic, it sounds kind of sweet and sorrowful. It's almost like I'm, I'm sad that my girlfriend left me or whatever. And then I go to the minor pentatonic. It's like, you know what? She was no good for me anymore. So whatever. You'll see how that all plays out. Keep your eyes peeled for this as we go. I will do a quick whistle stop tour. Here we go. So that is just one of the concepts we looked at last week. We also looked at using the blues scale in a slightly different way and not treating every note in the blues scale as being equal, specifically the flat five that we added, which we added either here on the fourth fret in the key of A, for argument's sake. Of course, other positions are available. We talked about the idea of using this as a passing note to either decorate in or out of our fifth or a fourth, or as a way to get that subtly flatted five that sounded so great. I'll just quickly throw that backing track on and show you what I'm talking about here. I'm gonna play some fifths, which is this E note right here, and then you'll notice me playing this fourth fret note. I'm gonna bend up ever so slightly. It's not gonna be fully up to pitch. It'll just be kind of like most of the way there. It's kind of like, like E flat 0.2 or whatever you want to think about it. I'll throw the backing track on and let me show you what we're dealing with there so we can get moving on with today's ideas. If you have any questions about this though, please do drop them in the comments. I would love to hear from you. We've got some really, really interesting locations where you guys are coming from. So let us know where you're from. We would love to hear where you're listening from, whether you're on Facebook, on YouTube. We would love to hear from you. So anyway, let's try this real quick. Here are our five. So that's a quick whistle stop tour of where we got up to in our last lesson. Let's pick up with some other blues concepts and we'll explain those for you guys now. Now, the reason we're doing this is, of course, because there's a ton of great advice out there for blues players, but, you know, sometimes it's kind of difficult to figure out how to apply this stuff. I'm here to try and demystify it for you just a little bit. So the next concept we're going to talk about is playing over the changes in a blues. Now, let me just clarify that very, very quickly. What I mean by playing over the changes is instead of sticking rigidly to one scale or just major and minor pentatonic, for example, in the key that you're in, so let's say we're in the key of E, just playing E major pentatonic, E minor pentatonic, rather than doing that, what we do instead is we alter the pool of notes that we're choosing from to match the chord that we're playing over. So if you were playing in the key of E, for argument's sake, when it got to the four chord, which would be an A chord, like so, you might alter your pool of notes so that you better reflect that A chord. And I'm going to show you how to do this in just a second. But first of all, let me show you what it's like when I don't play over the changes, and then when I do try to accentuate the changes. Because rule number one about playing over changes, in blues at least, this is not the case in jazz or in fusion, but in blues, rule number one of playing over the changes is that you don't have to if you don't want to. Right? There is no rule that says you absolutely must catch the changes. And in fact, some of the great blues guitar players of all time didn't bother. Stevie Ray Vaughan is a fine example of this. He's a fabulous player, I'm sure we'll all agree. Didn't do a great deal of playing over the changes. When he wanted to, he could do it like nobody's business, but he didn't always feel the need. Sometimes it's fine just to take that sledgehammer approach and just play kind of like through the changes almost. So you're just kind of taking one scale, in this case we're going to use E minor pentatonic, we might throw some major pentatonic in for good measure, and just blasting that without any real need to outline the chords. It sounds pretty cool. This is what it's like when I don't play the changes. So I'm going to throw a Stevie Ray backing track on just for argument's sake, available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, of course. Here we go. Habits die hard. I was really reaching hard on instinct to try and catch those changes there, because it's just something that I quite like to do, but you absolutely do not need to. So let's do a contrary example. I'll try not to play quite as many notes this time, and we'll do a contrary example where I try and outline the changes in our chord progression. You'll see what the difference is. In fact, I'll tell you how I'm going to do this. Let's do it even better. What I'm going to do is I'm going to outline the changes on the first pass, and then I'll completely ignore them on the second pass, and then I'll outline them again on the third pass, and you can hear the difference this has on the sound of the solo. Then I'm going to tell you how to do it. Okay, here we go. Let's go to close-up cam as well. Why not? Let's just take a close-up look at that fingerboard while we do this. Let's try. We'll be right back. All gaffes aside, you can hear there is a very profound difference between those two approaches, i.e. whether you're outlining the changes or whether you're just blazing through them with whatever pentatonic scale happens to be the one that you fancied using for that particular solo. Now, let me talk about probably what might be the least obnoxious and lowest effort way to outline the changes in your blues scale, which is, first of all, addressing what you're doing with the third of the chord that we're playing over and the seventh of the chord that we're playing over. So real quick, I'm going to show you this in the key of A so we can digest them a little bit more fully. We're going to go back to our A blues shuffle in just a second. This gives us a bit more time to do this. So real quick, if we play an A7 chord, like so, in fact, I'll play it like this, so that you guys can see what I'm playing a little more accurately. We've got an A note here, our seventh degree is G, and then we also have a C sharp note, which is here, and that is gonna be our third. So that fundamentally is the bones of our A7 chord. I just wanna flag up something that our man Rick Elliott from California has pointed out. Rick's saying tritone substitution chord scales over the primary dominant chords. Rick, I've got some stuff for you on that, so we'll come back to that. Okay, cool. So anyway, real quick, so there's our A7. When we go to our D7, just watch what happens to these two fingers right here. So D7. What we end up with is a third, which is F sharp, which is a semitone below our G note, right? So now, all of a sudden, that G note, which sounded so kind of positive and like part of this seventh chord right here, it still sounds cool, but suddenly this F sharp note sounds a little bit cooler because it's part of our chord. And likewise, what was our C sharp note before suddenly sounds a bit less cool because the chord is a C in it. Let me go back to our A, it's up yah. Let me show you real quick what happens to the E. You will notice that that is literally just two frets higher than our D chord, but what we've done here is we've taken this same cluster of seventh and third, and this time we have a G sharp for our third. This is important because suddenly these A's and these G's, they might not sound so great. They still sound pretty cool, but sometimes hitting this G sharp is a really, really cool thing. And also this A is going to sound pretty interesting. But also, as if that wasn't enough, our E is the root note of the chord now, which means we're going to have to treat our fifth a little bit more delicately. But anyway, that is kind of neither here nor there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw a really, really simple solo at you. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to stick with the idea of playing just two notes from our pentatonic scale, which in this case is going to be A, and then this note right here, which is going to be D. And then I'll play a two note cluster from the chords. You know what it is? We have a great comment. By the way, if your name comes up as Facebook user, if you're watching in the live stream group, just do me a favor, just go to facebook.com/StreamYard. There's a link in the description below. You don't have to do this, but it just means we can show your name on screen and not just Facebook user, but Rock and Roll by Led Zeppelin perfectly demonstrates this, among other things. Great song, it absolutely does perfectly demonstrate this. So real quick, what I'm gonna do, just to go back to our concept here, I'm gonna play a little solo using these notes, and whatever is going on here, or here for the four chord, here for the one chord, here for the five chord. So my pool of notes is gonna look something like this. Now already you can hear those chord changes going by without even having a backing track on, but let's throw that out there anyway, right? So I'm gonna throw the backing track on in the key of A. You will see exactly what's going on because I'm gonna change whether I'm playing these notes or these notes or these notes or these notes, depending upon the chord change. Let's just have a look at that. This is a really rudimentary way to outline these changes. We'll get into more detail in just a second, but let's try this first of all. We'll be right back. and so on and so forth. Now, again, this is just, like I say, a fairly rudimentary way of outlining these chord changes, but it just shows you what we're actually dealing with here. So in essence, if we expand this concept out a little bit further, what we can take is we can take the idea of our minor pentatonic scale. Let's just stick with the minor pentatonic now. You can apply the same process to the major pentatonic, but we can adapt it to fit whichever chord we're playing over. And what that means is we do a quick analysis for notes that aren't gonna sound super great against our chords, and we substitute them for notes that are gonna sound super great over our chords. And in the process, we make sure that we have all of our chord tones in there in our pool of notes. So real quick, let's go to the close-up cam. Let me show you how I might alter our minor pentatonic scale to work over the one chord. So the one chord is A. What we could do is we could take our minor pentatonic and then imagine playing an A7 arpeggio across the top of this. Now what this is hopefully highlighting is that the minor pentatonic contains most of the right notes, but without any C sharps. So what we can do is we can simply add a C sharp into our pool. And that's where this common trick comes from, that idea of kind of hammering on from the minor third to the major third. It works really great over the one chord, but if you ever tried this over every chord in your blues, you'll know that it's disastrous because it doesn't work over the four chord or the five chord unless you move to the pentatonic scale associated with that chord. But that's another story for just a second. So anyway, let's just take a look at that. So what we could do is we could take all of our C sharp, our C's, and just like slide them into C sharps or hammer them into C sharps, like so. And suddenly that works. But I would posit that perhaps a better way to do this is maybe just to bend them, and maybe don't take them all the way to the C sharp. So you can just bend them a little bit. So instead of going like this, we could go like this. And because the E note in this chord is the fifth, we can actually afford to flatten it slightly. So we can slightly sharpen our C sharps and slightly flatten our E notes to get a really cool and interesting effect, like so. So instead of playing this scale, now we have this. Which sounds a little wonky when you play it in scale form, but when you play it over a track, it sounds killer, like so. Let me just throw that on. I'm just gonna play this over the one chord. So we have an elongated one chord here. I'll just play it for as long as I can before the change, because you'll notice that it sounds disastrous over the change. In fact, to demonstrate this, when we get to the four chord, I'm gonna hit this lick to show you why this doesn't work. So you'll notice something sounds pretty cool over the one chord, and then we'll have all kinds of disaster over the four chord. Now, you guys couldn't hear me shouting really loudly there, but it does sound pretty nasty when we hit that C sharp note over our four chord. Now, the reason for that is because our four chord doesn't contain a C sharp note, so implying it doesn't do us any favors. What we can do instead, however, is just take all of those C's back to being common or garden neutral C's, or natural C's, without any alteration or any bends or any hammer-ons or any of that kind of stuff when it's time to play over the four chord. And we can also introduce this F sharp note, which is actually, like I say, it's the third of the chord. It's taken from a bunch of kind of modal scales, but I don't want you to think about it in those terms. We're gonna think more about just kind of like adding notes to our pool to reflect the chord that we're playing over. So what you might do there when you get to the four chord is you might sub this scale out . If you don't want to do this wonky fives, you don't have to. You can just do this. And over the four chord, we can play this. And you can can hear those chord changes go by as I play it. So let's throw the backing track back on, and you'll notice me make these substitutions. I'll try not to play a bunch of notes so you can see what's going on, and I'll maybe take a couple of passes at it just so we can see very, very clearly how this works. Bit carried away there, so we'll leave that for the time being. Now let's talk about ways that you might treat the five chord. Now there are some slightly more delicate ways we can handle the five chord. You don't have to hit the changes on the five, but we'll just throw that out there right now. You absolutely don't have to, but it can sound really cool. Now those of you who are kind of jazzers will be familiar with the idea that you can treat a five dominant chord as a five altered, and you can, but there are places and times to do this in blues, and the first five in the Barnum and nine of your 12 bar blues probably isn't the time to do it. The reason for this is that a five altered, which either contains a flat and or a sharp seven, flat and or a sharp five or nine. So there's sharp five, sharp nine. Here's flat five, flat nine, or any combination thereof, like so. All these kind of really spicy sounding chords. They sound really cool, and we can outline those in our playing by hitting a scale that we call the, we call it the altered scale. You can think about it as the superlocharine scale in the key of E, which would give you something, you might think about it as F melodic minor is another way to approach it. It would give you something kind of resembling this, which is a cool sound. Now let's not pretend it isn't. It's a very, very cool sound, but this works best when it's resolving to a one chord. So it works best if you take it from here and that sounds really killer. But if you don't resolve it, it can just sound a little bit like, I guess probably an analogy is that it would be like setting up a joke and then answering, like instead of having the punchline, you have the middle of a different joke. So let's say, you had a knock knock joke. You had like knock knock, who's there, doctor, doctor who, terrible joke, right? And let's say you have another one which would be like the old English joke, which is English, Irishman and Scotsman walk into a bar. A little bit problematic, but we're not going to get into that today. So it's an Irishman and Scotsman walk into a bar, Doctor Who. It doesn't really work because they both work in their own circumstances. But in this instance, because we're not using that strong resolution that you get from the five altered chord, doesn't really work when you go to the four chord. So if we play like so, let's go to the close-up cam. I mean, it's not a bad sound, don't get me wrong, it sounds cool, but it doesn't have that same super strong resolution as when we get to the one chord, like so. And away we go. So, the time to use this sort of stuff is absolutely when you're going from a 5 to a 1. So the best example of this is when you're going from the E chord in this instance back to the A chord at the start of the progression. Now, our backing track here doesn't actually have an E in the turnaround, but we can force it. We can play one and pretend it's there, and it still works. So let me show you what I mean with that real quick. If you're a little bit lost out on this stuff, by the way, I'll show you a very, very quick way that you can access these kind of sounds. And it's actually almost like so easy, it feels like cheating, but there is no cheating in music, right? It's just a cool way to get used to these sounds. So let me show you what I'm dealing with here. We're gonna hit some altered sounds over the end of our progression, going back around to the start. So let's take a listen. So you would have heard that momentary, sorry, I have a very itchy nose. You would have heard that momentary deviation away from stuff that sounds kind of like familiar. And we got a little bit of that jazzy thing kind of coming out. That sounds pretty cool. That's a good place to do it. There is actually another very, very common place to do this, which is forcing the change from the one chord to the four chord. Because if we imagined a piece in the key of D and D was the one chord, well, the five chord would be A. So if we have a blues in A, where we're going from A7 to D7, we can actually treat that as a 5-1 progression, because it kinda is. And we can force that by playing some altered type sounds over the A chord going into the D chord. Now, a really cool way to do this is to hit what's called the half whole diminished scale. It's something Robin Ford does all of the time, and if it's good enough for Robin Ford. Also, by the way, a man who apparently likes black Paul Reed Smith guitars. So not only is he an incredibly tasteful player, he also has great taste in playing in the instruments that he plays as well. So hey, Robin, you made a fine choice. So anyway, if you haven't seen that, by the way, go on Paul Reed Smith's Instagram and once this stream's done, and you'll see like kind of a tease of the new Robin Ford signature guitar. So anyway, real quick, half whole diminished. We won't go too far into it. You can think about it as a fingering shape, and you can think about it from A right here as being 1-2-4 on the E string and the G string, and then 1-3-4 on the B string and the D string. And we don't actually need to go any further than that for the purpose of demonstration. What you're about to hear is you're about to hear me play as normal over the one chord. And then in that transition to the four chord, you would have seen me play something a little bit more jazzy. That's our forced altered 5-1 thing that we're talking about. So this is a cool place to do it. It's actually in bar 4 of our progression. Very, very common place to add this kind of tension, but let's just throw that in now. There is actually another very cool place we can do it in, a quick change blues, but I'll show you that in a second. So real quick, here we go. Altered in bar 4 and then also in bar 12. Here we go. Had to sneak that in there, so we had to play a whole bunch of notes to get the tonality through, but you get the idea. You can of course be more economical with this once you you become a little bit more masterful with it, but that's a very cool way to handle these changes. Now, if you have a quick change blues, and what I mean by that is you have a blues where second bar is a four chord, so you might have a blues that goes something like this. In that instance, you can actually get away with throwing in an altered sound on bar number one, which can be pretty cool. Again, this is a Robin Ford trick. I think, I could be wrong, I'm gonna take a wild gamble here on live TV for you all, but I think our slow blues has that quick change. So if it does, that's exactly what I'm gonna do. Let's just find out for sure though. It does indeed. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to hit an altered sound on the B in this case. The progression is in the key of B. I'm going to hit an altered sound on the B. I will show you how to do these altered sounds too, by the way. I'm just going to show you that in a second because there's a very, very cool trick we can use for this. So let's fire away at that. I may start somewhere in the middle of the progression. Let's see. Okay, turnaround's coming up, so let's do an altered sound in bar one. So here comes bar number nine, use the F sharp. Kind of risky, especially when you're playing a slow blues and the progression is long, but it's something that you can absolutely do. There's also a very cool adage with this that Carl Verheyen, no less, came out with fairly regularly, which is you can play just about anything provided you apologize for it afterwards with some blues. A demonstration, I'm going to play some really egregious stuff and I'll play some blues licks after that. I also want to highlight a question here from our friend Blues Sumlin, who wants to talk about feel. We'll address that in the Q&A coming up, so get your questions in because we're going to do a full Q&A session in just a moment. Let's really quickly play some egregious stuff and then apologize for it with some blues licks. Let's see how that sounds. So on and so forth. Now, again, if you're just tuning in, don't worry, it hasn't been all tasteful, or at least I hope it hasn't been all tasteful stuff like that for the majority of our streams. So listen, guys, I would love to hear from you. If you have some questions, please do drop them in the chat. We have some great, great questions from you guys so far. I want to thank you again for taking the opportunity to, or rather, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank you for joining us on your Monday evening or your Monday afternoon, wherever you're watching from. We have some comments from all over the world. We've got George Daly from Newton Square, Pennsylvania. Our friend Rick from Martin County, California. We're going to talk about Rick's question regarding tritone substitution. It's more of a comment than a question. Rick knows what's going on with this stuff. We have Michael Almedia from, or Almedia, depending on how you want to pronounce that. I apologize if I'm butchering people's names. From Ontario, Canada. beautiful city, absolutely gorgeous. We have our friend Nan from India once again. Like, people from all over the world are joining us. And if you are watching, I would love to hear where you're watching us from. So throw us some love in the comments. If you haven't done so already, give that thumbs up button a click. I'm gonna be throwing you some Q&A stuff in just a second. But before we do, let me show you one super quick and easy way to hit these altered tonalities using a trick that our friend Rick has highlighted. Tricky Rick. I get that as well, being Nick, so I get Tricky Nick too, so that's fine. So we can, you know, we have almost homonym names, so we can kind of, we can connect on that. So anyway, okay, tritonal substitution chords over the primary dominant chords. What Rick is talking about here is the idea that you can play a dominant, essentially a dominant scale or a dominant arpeggio, a tritone away from any one of our dominant chords. Let's take A for argument's sake. You can play an arpeggio or a dominant sounding scale from the tritone, and what it'll give you is it'll give you an altered sound from the original root chord. So let me put that into context. So tritone on A, if you've ever played any Black Sabbath, you will know. Or if Hendrix is more your jam, you've got that. We've all seen that interval a bunch of times. This is the interval we think of as a tritone, so-called, because it is three tone intervals stacked one atop the other. Essentially, it's a flat five. You might think about it as, if you're playing on the wound strings, at least a string and a fret along. That's a way to do things. So basically, what we can do is if you play a dominant seven arpeggio or a dominant sounding scale from this tritone, what you get, the net result, is an altered sound from the original chord. So let me demonstrate a tritone arpeggio example from our A chord would be an E flat dominant seven arpeggio, which we could play a bunch of different places, but just to keep it simple, I'm actually gonna shoot all the way up the fingerboard so you can see when I do this, and I will play it like so. And you'll hear how that sounds dominant and like kind of altered and leading in this kind of cool jazzy way. It's a very mishmash of terms, but you'll see what's going on. So real quick. Very, very cool sound, and that's literally just me playing up and down the arpeggio. Now, a few spots we can throw this in, right? A very, very cool spot is to throw it in over the last chord of the bar, or rather the last chord of the progression, which is normally a five chord. You can treat it as a five dominant chord. If we're playing in the key of A, the tritone for our E chord is gonna be B flat. So B flat, if we're playing an A minor pentatonic, like so, we can literally just throw in a B flat dominant seven arpeggio, like so. Or, here's an even trickier way of doing it, an even like cheatier way of doing it. You could just play, rounding back on ourselves to earlier on in the lesson, you could just play the dominant variant of the minor pentatonic where we just bend all of the thirds up like so. Just play that in B flat. So provided you're handy with your bending, you can actually just play the minor pentatonic from the tritone of whichever chord you're playing, and you'll get essentially a tritone substitution. You do have to bend those thirds to make it work, but we're blues players, so we do that anyway, right? So let's find a really cool example where we can play this. Let's throw it in here. Let's throw it in on our bar number four, and we'll play this right there. That is E flat minor pentatonic, position number three. Okay, so it's based on fret number four. It is box shape number three. You'll see me drop that in on our backing track in bar number four, and it's gonna have this really cool leading effect. I'll just play it on its own first into the four chord. So we have. It's you got to be careful with it, but it does sound pretty cool in context. Let me just throw that at you right now. Here we go. Here's our backing track. Watch out for it in bar number four. And in fact, for good measure, I think when we get to the turnaround, I think I'll throw in that B flat minor pentatonic over what would be the E chord just to lead us through. So this is an example of tritone substitution without actually having to learn anything, which is always nice. Let's try that now. Now, hello. Trying to hit the space bar, I ended up hitting the wrong button on my little switcher instead. So, as with all of these things, fortune favors the bold. You really do have to commit with this stuff and accept that you are gonna sound a little bit sour, but I'm guessing that is sort of the idea. So guys, I was gonna play a little bit longer and I'm gonna give you a chance to get your questions in, but we're actually just gonna get stuck straight into the questions because we are coming up to 10 to the hour. Man, it is like 8:50 here already, and we only have an hour. These streams just seem to go on and on and on because there's so much great stuff to talk about. But I absolutely have some wicked questions that I want to talk about. So let's get in here real quick with our friend Paulie D's music, friend of the stream. Paulie D would like to know, what are your top three tips to play in the style of Peter Green? Well, as it happens, right, we had this conversation last week. Myself and Paulie and a few other guys, we talked about who my favorite British blues guitar player is, considering I'm from the UK. I said my favorite British blues player is Peter Green. I actually did a tech session, which is our name for a style file, on Peter Green for Guitar Interactive. That will be available in GI Plus very soon, actually. So if you want to really get deep into the Peter Green thing, you can absolutely get stuck in there. The first thing I would suggest, though, to really sound like Peter Green is the vibrato. So that's a huge deal, right? So Peter's vibrato, really, really characteristic. It is a lot faster than I tend to do my own, but it is buttery smooth. Now, if you play your vibrato really, really fast, it can sometimes sound a little bit nervous. And there are some players out there who get a bit of stick for this. There's one very famous metal guitar player in particular, but we're not gonna name names, right? Because that's not how we do things here. But you can end up sounding a little bit kind of amateur hour if you play vibrato like so. Let me just find the right sound for you real quick. If you play vibrato and make it really, really fast and ragged. Terrible, just awful, right? However, right, Peter had this wonderful way of playing a really super fast vibrato and making it sound sweet. Now, this just takes a bit of experimentation, but there are a few little tips that I can give you for this one. The first of which is to kind of take your thumb pressure back a little bit. So don't press terribly hard with your thumb. You're gonna keep your thumb on top of the fingerboard. You can't take it off and try and do it like so. I like to keep it up here for a bit of a fulcrum for the Peter Green thing, at least. All of the movement is gonna come from the kind of a forearm, this twisting motion like this, but we're gonna let the fingers hang really loose, the thumb's gonna be really loose, and that's gonna allow us to be consistent with our vibrato, and what we end up with is this kind of sound. It takes a bit getting used to. Now, when I did the tech session on Peter Green, this crept into my own playing, and I'm out there playing in my heavy metal band, and I'm hitting, you know, I'm doing the Malmsteen thing, and then playing the Peter Green vibrato in the end. It's a little incongruous, but it is a really, really cool sound. So that's tip number one. Tip number two I would give you also pertains to vibrato, and this is a very Peter Green thing. People fixate on the vibrato, myself included, but oftentimes Peter just wouldn't bother. So there'll be no vibrato on a note, and it's okay just to leave the notes hanging in the ether undecorated. Well, maybe something like this. So let's take that example again. So that's two tips. The third tip, and I think this was something that I kind of like hit upon when I was putting this tag session together, is that a lot of times what you find with Peter Green is you would find a lot of variation on a single phrase. So you take maybe this phrase right here. And there wouldn't be, any real, like, hurry to get away from that. Now, this is something that I feel on my own playing. I feel this urge to kind of, like, get away from, oh, no, I've played the same phrase a bunch of times. I need to play something else. I think we all do. And what we can probably learn from Peter Green is that you can actually hang out on a single musical idea for a long time and really get some good stuff out of it. So hopefully that's answered your question. Paulie, I would love to hear from you in our next week's stream. We'll be talking about more of the same sort of stuff because we still haven't covered everything. There's so much stuff to get into, but hey, what are you gonna do? Anyway, so a few other great questions, right? I want to touch on this one, right? This is Blues Sumlin. Blues playing with feel, how do you interpret this? In your opinion? Well, man, if this isn't the million-dollar question, I don't know what is. So I'm gonna try and break this down on the fly for you as best I can. Oh, we have a great question coming from Humble Pundit. I'm gonna throw that in at the end. We may go a little long here, so let's see. Stick with us. We may go a little over the hour, but I've got nowhere to be. So anyway, real quick, so how do you interpret playing blues with feel? Well, I guess probably the way I would do that is I'd maybe reframe the question slightly, and I'd maybe reframe it as playing blues with intention. And I think feel and intention a lot of times can be the same thing. So if you listen to great players like, everybody says B.B. King, right? But B.B. King is like the example of this. But let's take Peter Green, because we were just talking about Peter Green, right? A player with unbelievable feel. Everything Peter played was 100% intentional, and he owned every note that he played, and there was nothing that was just filler, so to speak. So if you're playing away and you're not really invested in every note that you're playing, you're not really aware of it, that then, you know, you can end up sounding like you're not playing with feel, so to speak. It's deeper than that, obviously. It goes much more to it than that. There's some technical stuff too that I will touch on, but I think the most important and the first step is to have some kind of like mental image of the lines that you're trying to play and really listen while you're playing. Listen very carefully. And if you're not getting the sound that you want, make some adjustments. This is something you can do in the practice room. You can also do it live. So in the practice room, the way you might adjust this, if you're not getting the notes that you want, try some different ones, right? Try the timing, try adjusting. But it all starts with this very, very clear mental image. In the live domain, often what it can be for me is it can be a sound thing. So oftentimes if I'm running too much gain, I really like to run quite a lot of gain. I come from that kind of Gary Moore school of blues player where I figure, you know, you can always turn it down. So we have a volume control on the guitar for a reason. I will say as well, by the way, real quick, to show you these. These are the new Fishman Fluence Greg Koch signature P90s. They're pretty subtle, but you can see the swoosh there. They turn down unbelievably well, just like phenomenally so. It's like having a volume pedal on your guitar. So that makes life really, really simple. Anyway, so that's kind of the intentionality side of things. I think it's really important to be aware of this stuff, to react on the fly. A technical thing, when it comes to me, for feel for me, is making sure that you don't associate emotion with tension. This is something Mark Knopfler has said. So don't think because you're going to play something that's really intense that you need to approach it with this full body tension. What you're trying to create is the sound of excitement and aggression, but you don't necessarily have to embody that in your hands, so to speak. So if we take a classic Stevie Ray Vaughan lick that does require a little bit of aggression, we could play something like so. We could play. Thank you. Now, that's stuff that is fairly intense to play, but it's very, very important that, for me at least when I'm playing that sort of stuff, is not to become a ball of tension while I'm doing this, because it never sounds good. You have to stay in control, and that again comes from listening to the sound that you're playing with and being very, very intentional about what you play. I could get into this subject. You know what it is? In fact, I feel like this is a subject for an entire live stream, is the playing with feel thing. You can, of course, check out my course, which is The Ultimate Guide to Melody and Phrasing, where we talk about this stuff at some length. You can check that out at GI Plus. Plug, plug, plug. But that's another topic for another day. So we're going to take one more question real quick. Oh, man, our friend The Humble Pundit has said he put the gristle tone pickups in his telly. Those pickups are amazing. I am such a convert, right? I was like a real, real crazy skeptic about the whole Fishman thing. But I played them at NAMM, and it was just the greatest neck pickup tone I'd ever heard ever. And I was just like talking to it was Ken Susie, but I didn't know who it was at the time. I was just talking him away in the booth, and I was going, my God, what is this guitar? What is the amp? What is the amp? And like, why does this sound so good? Is it the cabinet? And he's going, nah, man, it's the pickups. And I'm like, it can't be. I don't believe you. I don't believe you. It's gotta be the amp. It's surely this is an amp I've never seen before. And he's like, nah, bro, it's the pickups. He's right. It's 100% right. So anyway, that's the thing. So Humble Pundit, real quick, how do you incorporate the diminished scales into your blues playing? Well, probably the easiest way to do this, and the way I like to do this the most, is when it's time to force an altered tonality. That's how I like to do this stuff. So forcing an altered tonality is something we talked about just a moment ago. It's things like, for example, where you're playing over the one chord and you want to force an altered change to the the four chord. So you could throw something like this in. Now, what that was is a half-whole diminished scale, but the half-whole diminished scale is basically just two diminished seventh arpeggios, a semitone apart. So in this case, we're playing in the key of A. It's an A half-whole diminished. You could just play A diminished sevenths and B flat diminished sevenths and get the same result. Now, a cool way to play that is to play this A shape and this B flat shape, which I always think of as the Andy James shape. It's the one that, you know, I remember seeing the Malmsteen thing over and over again. Which, of course, everyone uses, maybe not blues. But it's something that we use fairly regularly, something I saw Andy do, which was just like, oh, duh, why didn't I do that before? Maybe don't try that on live TV with a clean tone, but you get the idea. Was to play the same sort of voicing on the B and B, G, and D strings. So you get this kind of sound. Which is quite a cool way to force that altered change. Now, another fun thing with this is you can actually use the other diminished scale, which is the whole half diminished scale, the one less traveled. Over the four chord, if you're careful. Now, I say careful, you gotta be super careful about this and you really gotta own it. So let's try that very quickly over our four chord in the slow blues. I'm gonna play B, it's in the key of B, so slow blues in the key of B. Over the E7 chord, I'm gonna play B half whole diminished. You'll see what I'm getting at with this. It kind of almost sounds a little bit like melodic minor, which is pretty cool. So we get this. Wrong blues. Let's try that again. Here we go. We've got so many blues backing tracks lined up. So again, some stuff you got to be brave with there. But a humble pilot has paid me, a humble pundit has paid me a fabulous compliment there, saying that sounds like Steve Lukather. Man, I wish. If you haven't done so already, by the way, check out Sam Bell's Steve Lukather Tech Session, which is now available on GI Plus. It was in the previous edition of Guitar Interactive magazine. It's available in GI Plus. You can check that out. Sam does a absolutely wonderful, wonderful Steve Lukather vibe, and he goes over all that kind of killer stuff, from what I remember. Of course, Sam's a very good friend and a great, great player to boot. But thank you so much, my man. That is a fabulous, fabulous compliment. Last week, I was sort of told my playing reminded somebody of Chris Buck, so I screen capped it. I'll be screen capping this one too. In fact, you know what? I'm gonna do that right now. There we go. Screen cap. Sounds like Steve Lukather having it. So anyway, my friend Baptiste says, hey Nick, how are you? I'm very good, my man. You are joining us at the end of our stream, but we'll be back next week. We're here every Monday, same time. So it is 8 p.m. British Summer Time, 3 p.m. EST. It works at about 12 lunchtime, kind of midday on the West Coast. We have a friend from India as well, man. So whatever time zone you're in, we're really, really happy to have you. Thank you so much for tuning in. My name's Nick for Guitar Interactive Magazine. This has been Blues Concept Explained Part 2. I feel like a Part 3 is brewing, so maybe we'll do that next week. If you guys would like to see some more blues stuff, by the way, drop us a message in the comments and let us know if this is the sort of thing you're into or if there's anything else that you'd like us to cover. So if you'd like us to cover more metal stuff or more rock stuff, fusion, you name it, we can absolutely do that. But blues is a lot of fun, right? It's kind of the root of all the stuff. So drop us a line in the comments. We would love to hear from you. I'd love to talk about more stuff that you guys are into, so let us know what you'd like us to cover. Arturo says, greetings from Mexico. Man, Arturo, it's great to have you. Thank you very much. It is a very good melodic minor with a void note. You know what it is? You're absolutely right there with this whole business of the half-whole diminished. Because it's eight notes in it, it's kind of like... it's a more risky melodic minor, is kind of a way to think about it. It's a melodic minor for people who like to live dangerously. So anyway, guys, I'm going to bid you adieu. Do drop us a message, drop us a like, share this video with your guitar playing friends. It will still be available once we're done. Blues Someone says, blues and more blues, please, Nick. Hey, man, I will talk about blues all day until the cows come home. That makes me real happy. But of course, if there's anything else you guys would like to hear, we'd love to chat to you. So let us know. I will speak to you guys next week. Thank you so much. I will see you guys later. Our friend Pete C, friend of the stream, says, late to the session, but we'll watch later. Thanks. Pete, glad to have you, man. Better late than never. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you've got any questions, of course, you can fire them into the Guitar Interactive live stream hub. We will be picking up questions from there too. So anything you'd like me to elaborate next week, I absolutely will. So I'm going to leave you guys in a minor blues because we've played all dominant stuff so far. Keep your eye out for some of the concepts that we've discussed. Obviously, no blending of minor and major pentatonics because that's going to sound a bit weird. But even still, some minor blues stuff. I will try my level best and I'll see you guys in the stream next week. Thank you so much. My name's Nick Jennison.